All right, well, good morning. I'm here this morning to spend a couple minutes to talk to you about an upcoming event in our church, something that we've never done in our 132-year history of this church. Some of you don't know that our church is 132 years old. I want to just take a minute and lay out that history for you. 1885, there were 12 people in town of Stockbridge that wanted to have a Baptist church here. So they got together in a group and prayed and met and did Bible study. 12 of them. What's that sound like? Sounds like a small group, right? So the founding of our church way back then, 1885. About 12 years later, they built the church. That's still on the square. It's the second building on the square. The church flourished for many years. They had up in the 50s, there was 90, 95 plus people going to church there, regularly attending. In the early 80s, the church had gone down to about 28 people. They had hired a new young pastor. That young pastor took that church from 28 to about 300. We had some difficulties. In 2003, the church went down to like 85. And then about a year and a half later, we hired another new young pastor. And he has brought the church from 85 to almost 300 again, and that's Pastor Brian. So in 2003, Pastor Brian started. We are going, as the screens say, have a pastor sabbatical. What that's saying is that Pastor Brian is going to get a break. We're going to give him a break for 3 months. The idea is that the first month is winding down, getting everything out of his system, so to speak, that's church-wise. He's been taking care of us. He's been ministering to us all for 14 years now, and so it's going to take him a little bit of time. Then there's 30 days or a month in there where he's going to read books, just kind of unwind, get in touch with the Lord, spend time in prayer, do specific things for him to grow spiritually. And then the last month is kind of coming back and getting back in the groove and winding back up. The idea is kind of like trying to jump on a moving train. You can't just stand still and jump on that train. You got to kind of run alongside it for a ways, get the same speed, and get back into it. So what this is an opportunity for him to spiritually grow and be prepared for what God has for us next. What we're going to do is on Sunday, June 11th, we're going to have a service that's just kind of a send-off saying goodbye. That's his last sermon for 3 months. So it'll be June 12th will be the start of it. And then September 5th will be when he comes back, will be his first Tuesday. I think that's Monday is Labor Day. So Tuesday, September 5th will be his first day back. September 10th he'll be back in the pulpit. So that means we have 3 months there to fill. So we got some really great videos, and we'll be doing video sermons for 3 months. No, we're not. No. Okay? We have got other things planned to fill the pulpit. There may be, I think we've got like three of them in there. Otherwise, there are, Doug has gone on a missionary trip. Vicky's leaving on a missionary trip pretty soon, so they'll have a Sunday to talk about their missionary trips and how we can participate in what they did. We've got some other missionaries coming in and talking to us. There's other pastors coming in. So those will be filled with live people. We have things coming in and going on in our church, so it won't be just a bunch of videos for the next 3 months in that time frame. Okay, while he's away, please pray for him and his family so he can get this refreshing and he can come back vigored and having a good plan for us and where we go. God's got big plans for us. I don't believe he's finished with us yet. A long time ago, I believe it's a church of 500, and we're not there yet. So I still think he's got some place for us to go. So if you have any questions about this sabbatical, come and see us afterwards. We'll be glad to answer that. And, communication. Thank you. There are through this time, it isn't just being abandoned. You're gonna come back and talk to the elders if we have an emergency that comes up for a funeral or some big event, there's Steve from the Mason First Baptist Church. He's been here a couple times, preached in the pulpit. We know him. And there's another one if he's unavailable. Brian Bancroft will twice a week go over to the office, make sure things are going on there, the staff is taken care of. On June 12th, Pastor Brian will turn off his phone, he'll turn off his Facebook, he'll turn off his email, okay? So we're not going to be talking to him while he's gone. No Facebook. That's hard to believe for him, right?
Yeah.
But he won't be there. He'll probably be signed in a different name or have something.
If you see him on Facebook, you let us know.
Yes. Yes. There's, like I said, there's a letter coming out tomorrow. It'll be emailed to everyone. And then if you have any questions, come see us.
Hi, my name is Alex, and I have found victory through Christ in the midst of depression.
Hi, my name is Chris Stout, and by God's wonderful and perfect grace, I struggle well with lust and pornography.
Hi, my name is Audrey, and I'm a believer in Christ who struggles with sexual addiction.
Hi, my name is Barb, and I am experiencing forgiveness and restoration for my past infidelities.
My name is Lindsay, and I'm a believer who struggles with alcoholism, guilt and shame, and smoking. Prior to becoming a believer, I found my significance in men and work. I went from one long-term relationship to another, and I drank a lot in order to escape from my problems and my fears. But what I found was this just served to compound one problem on top of another. When I became a believer at the age of 28, I continued to drink. What this brought on was a lot of conviction and a lot more problem. As I continued to drink for the next 2 years, I also began to spin out. I hit my rock bottom and went to the church and asked them for help. I couldn't handle it anymore. I knew that I could go one of two ways, the way of my old life or the way I knew the Lord wanted me to go. The church suggested that I go to the ministry of Celebrate Recovery the following Monday night, and I did. Jesus Christ met me at the door and he said, "You are going to find love and healing here," and he was right. Every promise that Jesus made to me has been fulfilled. I found freedom, I found love, and I found grace at Celebrate Recovery.
I'm Brandon, and I find freedom in knowing that my decision to have an abortion was not greater than my decision to accept Christ as my Savior.
Hi, I'm Kim, and I am learning to tell you the truth.
My name's Leonard, and I'm a believer who struggles with homosexuality. And even introducing myself that way sounds awkward and it bugs me sometimes, but I'll tell you one thing that it helps me hear myself say that is that I can be a believer and I can struggle. And if you asked me 5 years ago if I had hope, I would have told you. I was hopeless. CR provides a safe place where you can find hope when you're hopeless. And it helped me with level setting my sin. It wasn't worse than anybody else's, and I could sit around with other men that had the same struggles, and when I said something, they would be waiting for me to be finished so that they could share their struggle. And there was no condemnation. And that's Jesus right there. That's a glimpse of his work on the cross, the forgiveness, the mercy, and the grace that you can find for whatever you're dealing with.
Hi, I'm Jenny, and I'm free from the bondage of drugs in my life.
Hi, I'm Joy, and in Christ, one day at a time, I'm finding victory over alcohol.
My name is Eric. I'm a believer who has been bound by guilt and shame, but I found confidence through faith in Christ.
Hi, my name is Lee, and I'm a believer in Christ who struggles with an eating disorder. For most of my life, food was everything to me. It was my best friend, and at the same time, it was my worst enemy. My love for food controlled me. I would use food as a way to meet my need for community or companionship, as a means of dealing with emotions like anxiety or fear or insecurity or feelings of unworthiness. I was completely consumed with my love for food. I came to CR and was just weary of this battle. Felt like I had lived every day of my life fighting this, and I was just tired of it. But through CR, the Lord has done more than I could have asked for or imagined. He has transformed parts of my heart and my life that I couldn't have even asked for Him to change. He's equipped me with the tools of prayer, of believing and meditating on His Word, and of being honest about my struggle with other people. And I've seen Him restore hope and healing that I never even dreamed of.
Hey, I'm Laura, and I'm a believer that is learning how to find my significance in Christ versus finding my significance in the way other people view me.
I'm Pam, and my confidence in Christ has helped me overcome my fear of rejection.
Hi, my name is Merritt, and I have an addiction to people and a fear of what they think of me. In recovery circles, we call it codependency. I came to celebrate recovery after hurt from a previous relationship. I was crying all the time. I didn't know how to fix myself, and all I really wanted to do was feel better. Working through the steps at CR, I learned that it's really not about me. It's not about what I can do to fix myself or actually to even feel better. It's about Christ and what He can do in my life and how His power works through me to change my struggles and the way that I have operated for more than 30 years.
I am Susan, and I am a believer in Jesus Christ who is struggling well with pride.
I'm Carlos. By accepting God's grace, I'm able to forgive today.
Well, my name is Todd, and I'm a believer who struggles with shame, fear, and pornography. I had my first exposure to porn when I was about 10 years old, and my exposure continued up and through my adult years. And I kept it somewhat under control, or so I felt, for a while, until a series of circumstances in my adult life pushed me really to the brink of where I was considering suicide. And in the process of trying to recover from this, I went to some counselors, and one of those counselors suggested Celebrate Recovery. And when I came to CR, I was intrigued by what I saw, but frankly, I wasn't impressed, because I was pretty impressed with my own intellect, thought I knew a lot, and I wasn't hearing anything I hadn't heard before. And so I quit coming after a few months. About 6 months later, after floundering, I found a testimony on the Watermark website of another guy who also struggled with pornography. And I remember being impressed by God telling me, you know, He's getting some recovery and you're not. And so, would you rather walk around feeling like you're the smartest guy in the room, or would you like to maybe try this out and swallow your pride? And so I did that and came back, and it was a much different experience the second time. I learned to be vulnerable and to talk about my struggles even when I'd blown it. And so I come out the other side of that being thankful, frankly, for how I've been made.
Okay, so welcome to CR Sunday. I know you weren't all expecting that. So as you can see from that video, people in CR deal with a lot of different issues, not just drugs and alcohol, not just pornography, but a lot of different things. I would venture to say that in CR here at Crossroads, there is someone dealing with every single one of those issues you heard up there and more. We've been doing Celebrate Recovery for a year and a half now. And the leadership has faithfully been here every week after week. But a couple weeks ago, we lost one of our participants. And it was definitely Satan trying to beat up people in this community. and it beat up on CR a little bit. But what Satan means for evil in our lives, God will use for good. And what happened in CR was that it reinvigorated the leadership, made us realize that some of the people that come into CR, people mostly that are dealing with addictions, have three ways to go. They can get into recovery, they can go to an insane asylum, or they can die. Only three options for them. And it reminded us that what we're dealing with in a lot of cases are life and death struggles. So the leadership became reinvigorated. We're moving forward after that terrible event, and our participants seemed to be more involved. We had a lot of people who chose to get into step studies right after that. Step studies are like small groups where people work on themselves really intensely. So it has done good things for Celebrate Recovery, but we can't do this alone. The people that show up on Thursday nights and the people that run the step studies on other nights are doing everything they can to make this ministry work. But it's not just the 20 of us that make this happen, it's the whole church. It takes this whole church to make this ministry work. And you're probably sitting there saying, well, I don't have time on Thursday night. We got Thursday night covered, okay? This is what we need, what you see up here on this screen. We need you to pray. We need you to put us on your prayer list that you pray daily for the leadership, for them to have commitment and wisdom. We need you to pray for our participants, that they commit to their recoveries, that they get in step studies, that they do the things they need to do to work through the steps. We need you to provide. We're not asking you to send us a whole lot of money, but if you could put a couple bucks in an envelope every week and mark Celebrate Recovery on it, all of us together can make a huge difference in our funding. Also, in provision, the small groups have been doing a wonderful thing for Celebrate Recovery. They've been providing us with our meals. Every Thursday night, we start off with a fellowship meal where all the participants and the leadership all come together, we eat together, we sit and talk together, and for some of our participants, that meal is their meal for the week. The rest of the week, they're struggling to find food, but Thursday night, man, they know they're going to get a good meal, okay? So your ministry to them as a small group providing those meals is fantastic. Now, we've got about 9 small groups providing right now, so a small group only has to provide like once every 3 months or so. It's not a huge commitment, but what you're doing makes a huge difference, and I really thank you for that. If your small group is not currently doing that, I'd like you to consider it. It's a big help. We'd love to get enough so that small groups would only have to do it once every 4 months. The last thing that you can do to really help this ministry is promote it. Because a lot of the people that come to the ministry are doing that anonymously or in secret, they aren't going to go out and tell other people about this ministry because they don't want people to know that they're involved in it. As a result, sometimes the word doesn't get out, even in a small town like ours. So they were handing out some flyers earlier. Would you raise a flyer up if you have one? Got one in your hand? Yeah, okay. You are the lucky people. Please take that flyer and post it somewhere this week. I don't care where you post it. Wherever you post it, Jesus will see it. You can put it on a tree or a urinal. It doesn't matter, okay? There is a place that Jesus wants that poster, and someone who needs to see it is going to see it. So it would be a big help to have those put up. We are going to go through the process. I don't know what I did with my list. We're going to go through the process of CR this week just like we do on Thursday nights, so you'll have a chance to experience it. And we always start out with the road to recovery.
on the road to recovery, step by step, day by day. I'm on the road to recovery, trusting God along the way, trusting God all the way.
Okay, great. This is our hybrid band. Let me just pray before we get into some serious worship here. Heavenly Father, you are amazing God. You are awesome and powerful, and you've made this beautiful world for us, Lord. Please forgive us of what we don't do that we should, Lord, and please forgive us of the things we do that we shouldn't. Thank you for loving us and caring for us. Thank you for getting involved in our lives down to the smallest detail. Please be with us today as we worship. Please let it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ears, Lord. Please be with us in the message and in all of our service today, that you would be the focus of what we're doing here. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
From the heights, I will breathe.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're a living hope. Your presence. I've tasted and seen the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord. tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone in your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God. teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Heavenly Father, as we come to you with our tithes and offerings, I just pray that we realize that all you give us is a blessing from you. And that I pray that we would give joyfully to you, Lord. That we would give to you the tithes and offerings that you called for and that you deserve. Please bless us in our giving, Lord, regardless of the amount. In Jesus' name, amen.
In Luke 6:43-45, Jesus says, "For no good tree bears bad fruit, nor again does a bad tree bear good fruit. For each tree is known by its own fruit."
Thank you.
Now I will live, I'll live in you.
Amen. Woo.
We've had kind of a hybrid band today. Not all of our CR band could make it, so Dale brought in some people from the worship team, regular worship team, and they all got together and they made some good music, didn't they? Yeah. Okay, I forgot to do something that's important in CR. Doug was supposed to remind me. I'm a faithful believer in Jesus Christ. I'm in recovery from drug and alcohol addiction. I struggle with bipolar disorder, and my name is Mike. Okay, we are guided through our recoveries by the eight principles, and Mary's going to come up here and lead us through them.
Good morning. Sure, I can step up and help in that area, and God has done so much in and through me, and I just really would encourage you to check us out. So, all right, join me in the eight principles. I will read the principle, and then if you'll follow after me with the scripture. Number one, realize that I am not God. I admit that I am powerless to control my tendency to do the wrong thing, and my life is unmanageable.
Happy are those who know they are spiritually poor. Matthew 5:3.
Earnestly believe that God exists, that I matter to him, and that he has the power to help me recover.
Happy are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Matthew 5:4.
Consciously choose to commit all my life and will to Christ and care and control.
Happy are the meek, Matthew 5:5.
Openly examine and confess my faults to myself, to God, and to someone I trust.
Happy are the pure in heart, Matthew 5:8.
Voluntarily submit to every change God wants to make in my life, and humbly ask him to remove my character defects.
Happy are
Evaluate all my relationships, offer forgiveness to those I have hurt, and make amends to those, evaluate all my relationships and offer forgiveness to those who have hurt me and make amends for harm I've done to others, except when to do so would harm them or others.
Happy are the merciful,
Matthew 5:7.
Happy are the peacemakers,
Matthew 5:9. Reserve a daily time with God for self-examination, Bible reading, and prayer in order to know God and his will for my life and to gain the power to follow his will. And then number eight, yield myself to God to be used to bring this good news to others, both by my example and by my words.
Happy are those who are persecuted because they do what God requires, Matthew 5:10.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mary.
Okay, we have some announcements that we give out at CR every week, and Some of them are things you may be interested in. We always tell everyone about the Sunday services because a lot of people that come to CR do not go to church here. So we always tell them, please come and visit us on Sunday morning, that there's a reasonable number of very strange people here. They should fit right in. There's pig roast coming up, April 23rd, right after 11 o'clock service, pig roast and fish fry. It's a good time to get together with the church. You know, it's one of the few times that the 9:15 and the 11 o'clock service get together, so you're going to see a lot of people that you don't see very often, or people you don't even know, for that matter. What is truth? A new class coming up. It's going to be held during the first service, April 23rd through May 21st. There's a weekend step study for men coming up on Saturdays at 4:30. It's starting on the 29th of April. Step studies, for those of you who are new to this, are kind of like a small group, except the group works through the 12 steps of recovery one at a time. It's a time for very serious introspection, trying to find out what the things are in you and in your past that are leading you to the compulsive behaviors that you're exhibiting in your present. We need a leader for a Women's Journey Continues step study. See Micah Randy. The men's breakfast is Saturday morning at 8 a.m. We have good food and a lesson. The series lessons we're doing right now are about marriage. They're called Be Her Hero. The subtitle is How Not to Suck as a Husband. The Truth Project is Tuesdays at 7 p.m. It's a small group for men. It meets in the conference room. There's some other CRs in the area. Pinckney has one on Tuesdays at the People's Evangelical Free Church, and Fowlerville has one on Tuesdays at the United Brethren Church. Grass Lake has one on Fridays at the Family Worship Center. They just started theirs up a few months ago, and we're pretty excited to have a Celebrate Recovery down in that part of the county now. Celebration Night is a special night in CR. It's the last Thursday of every month, starts at 6. We don't have our regular meal. We have a pizza dinner, and we have a live band that night, and we give out the chips for every month. I'm sure you've heard of the chips that you get, like with AA and stuff, these kind of things that you carry in your pocket. The night is a really good night for worship and fellowship. Usually we have a higher attendance those nights, so our groups are more diverse. If you've been thinking about coming to CR, the last Thursday of the month is a great night to come and get introduced to it. Today's lesson is on action. CR has 26 lessons that we do throughout the year, and they're interspersed with 26 testimonies, so we cover 52 weeks of the year. And the lesson this week is action. It's a lesson I gave just a few weeks ago in CR, and we're going to talk about Principle 3 and Step 3. Principle 3, as you just saw up here, says, I consciously choose to commit all my life and will to Christ's care and control. It says, first, my life, and then my will, because it's virtually impossible to turn your will over to Christ without having turned over your life first. Step 3 says we made a decision to turn our lives and our wills over to the care of God. Romans 12:1 urges this when it says, therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. Working Principle 3 means that you've already stopped denying that you have some issues that affect your behavior, and you believe God can restore you. Do you have the ability to work through these issues without a recovery group? Yes, definitely. A lot of people work through their issues without a recovery group. Can God heal you instantly of your hurts, your hang-ups, and your habits? Yes, he can. But once you're healed, then what? Being delivered of these issues doesn't stop Satan from attacking you. And once you're delivered, he's going to attack you all the more to try to lure you back into slavery. So let's get out of slavery. Principle 3 is all about action. Choosing to commit is an action. You know the difference between right and wrong. All people were created with a conscience. The problem is not knowing the difference. It's choosing to do the right thing. That's where we get hung up. Some people are so indecisive when they're trying to do the right thing, you'd think they're so indecisive that their favorite color is plaid. Putting off a decision to accept Christ as your Savior is to choose not to accept Christ. To not decide is to decide. Revelation 3:20 says, "Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me." To not do principle three, whether you're dealing with issues or not, is to reject Christ. To reject Christ is to choose to go to hell. Putting off that decision is to choose to be separated from God for all eternity. So let's talk about the action we need to take. In Celebrate Recovery, we have an acrostic for everything. So here's our acrostic for action. A stands for accept. C stands for commit. T stands for turn it over. I stands for it's only the beginning. O stands for one day at a time. And N stands for next step. If you're trying to write these down, you'll see it more later, so don't get too tied into it. A stands for accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and higher power. Make a once-in-a-lifetime choice to let Jesus into your heart. Satan is saying, put this off. In Romans 10:9, God tells us how to make and express this choice. If you confess that Jesus is Lord and believe that God raised him from death, you will be saved. It is only after you accept Jesus that you can begin to commit. Are you dealing with an issue? Are you trying to screw up your courage, your willpower to lose that 40 pounds? In principle three, willpower takes on a new meaning. By committing our wills to God, we open up the door for God's power in our lives. In Psalm 143:10, we pray, "Teach me to do your will, for you are my God. May your good spirit lead me on level ground." Many people want Jesus to be their Savior, but few want him to be their Lord. Okay, if you don't hear anything else today, wake up and hear this. Many people want Jesus to be their Savior, but very few want him to be their Lord. Proverbs 3:6 says, "In everything you do, put God first, and he will direct you and crown your efforts with success." In everything. Not just the big things, not just the problems, everything. Have you ever seen one of these dashboard Jesuses that people put on their dashboard? You know, watch this Jesus left turn. You ever seen those things? Okay, people put them on shelves. You know, they put a little statue of Jesus on a shelf. That's kind of like the convenience Jesus, you know? You're doing okay with your life. You're driving just fine. And suddenly you got a big problem. You pull down Jesus off the shelf and you say, "Hey, Jesus, I need some help here." And as soon as you get going again, you can put Jesus back on the shelf and take control, you know? Driving the car of your life down the road. The problem is, sometimes you get going down that road and all of a sudden you realize you're screaming at 80 miles an hour toward a cliff, and when you're 200 feet away, you say, "Jesus, here, take the steering wheel, I'm in trouble." Does he stop you from going over the cliff? No. There's consequences to our actions. We bear the consequences of those actions. But he will guarantee that if he is Lord of your life, something good will happen from going over that cliff. Jesus doesn't just want a relationship with part of you. He wants you all in. Jesus rephrases this verse. It's up here in Matthew 6:33 when he says, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be given to you as well." Did you come here today carrying a burden? Do you have a hurt, a hang-up or a habit you're dealing with, give your will up to God. Make him the Lord of your life, not just your Savior. In Matthew 11, 28 through 30, Jesus says, "Come to me and I will give you rest. All of you who work so hard beneath a heavy yoke, wear my yoke, for it fits perfectly. And let me teach you, for I am gentle and humble. And you shall find rest for your souls, for I give you only light burdens." If you're sitting here saying, "I'm saved, no problem here," I want you to evaluate something. Is Jesus the Lord of your life, or is he just your Savior? Are you still the Lord of your life? One day you're going to have to stand before him in a day of judgment, and you're going to have to answer for the decisions you made in this life. Will you honestly be able to say, "I let you in all the way"? If not, today's the day. The I in action stands for "it's only the beginning." Accepting Jesus as Lord of your life is only the beginning. It's a new beginning. You begin the lifelong process of spiritual growth. It's a beginning of a true relationship with Jesus Christ, who is the creator of the world. Philippians 1:6 says, "God, who began a good work in you, will keep right on helping you grow in his grace until his task within you is finally finished." I like another translation. It says, "He who began a good work in you will be faithful to complete it." Principle 3 is what starts your growth as a Christian. Before you take this step, you're a baby Christian. Jesus is your Savior, but not your Lord. After you take this step, you can begin to grow and mature and become more like Christ. But this is not a destination. It's a journey. This is a process that will only be complete once you meet Christ. It's a process that we go through one day at a time. Our spiritual growth occurs one day at a time. What day is this? It's today. It's this Sunday, right now. Our growth occurs today. It doesn't occur in the past, and it doesn't occur in the future. We focus on yesterday. If we worry about tomorrow, we're wasting the precious time of today. Only in the present can we change our lives and grow. We can't change the past. We can only pray about the future. Jesus gave us instruction in living this philosophy when he said in Matthew 6:34, right out loud, "Don't be anxious about tomorrow. God will take care of your tomorrow too. Live one day at a time." It's right there. Jesus' words, "Live one day at a time." If I could go back and change the past, I would. Many's the time I said, if I could go back to my 17-year-old self and tell him everything I know right now for that turn. And then as they make their turn, aircraft carrier is kind of top-heavy. If they turn too sharp, too fast, it tips over. They have to make gradual, small course corrections to gradually turn that aircraft carrier around. And eventually they get going the opposite direction. But it's a gradual process. It's not an immediate process. Finally, the last letter of action stands for next step. The next step is not step 4. The next step is to ask Jesus into your life as your Savior and your Lord. Why am I stressing "and your Lord"? Well, let me tell you a little illustration. Maybe it'll get this point across in an uncomfortable way. There's a man who dies, and he goes to heaven, and he's standing at these pearly gates we all hear about, okay? And he notices that there's this long line of people waiting to go in the pearly gates, and there's this other group of people standing over here. And he stands in line and he waits, and finally he gets to St. Peter and he tells St. Peter his name, and St. Peter looks down the list and he comes to the name. He says, okay, great, you go stand over there with that group. And the man looks over in that group and he sees Satan standing there. And he says, no, no, St. Peter, I believe. I believe. I don't need to go with Satan. And St. Peter says, yeah, well, Satan believes too. Did you make Jesus the Lord of your life? Jesus said, what did you do with me? He didn't just say, do you believe in me? So how do you do this? How do you make Jesus the Lord of your life? It's real simple. Pastor Rick Warren, one of the founders of Celebrate Recovery, has developed an easy way to establish a spiritual basis for your life. And guess what? It's an acrostic. The word base, the letters stand for B, do I believe that Jesus died on the cross for me and showed he was God by coming back to life? 1 Corinthians 15:2 through 4 states clearly, by the gospel you are saved, if you hold firmly to the word I preach to you, otherwise you have believed in vain. For what I received, I passed on to you of first importance, that Christ died for our sins, according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised from the dead on the third day, according to the scriptures. Do you believe that? A stands for, do I accept God's free forgiveness for my sins? Romans 3:22 clearly says, this righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. The S in base stands for, do I switch to God's plan for my life? Romans 12:2 tells us, do not conform to the pattern of this world. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Do not conform to this world. You need to switch to God's plan. Finally, and maybe the most difficult part of this word base is the E. Do I express my desire for Christ to be the director of my life? In the book of Romans, in the 10th chapter and the 9th verse, it says, if you declare with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. If you declare with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord of your life, and if you believe in your heart that he was raised from the dead, you will be saved. Now let's bow our head and close our eyes. Now with every head bowed, every eye closed, please look inside your own heart. Ask God in the name of Jesus to reveal the truth about your salvation. Do you believe that God raised Jesus from the dead? Do you truly believe that? Do you believe that God raised Jesus from the dead? Satan believes that too. If you do, you're only halfway there. That's a big step. That's the first step.
You give life, you are alive.
Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. Pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs.
Have you expressed that to God? Have you told him that you believe? Words have power. Come to the altar now and express that to him. Kneel here now and express to God that you believe he raised Christ from the dead. Take that first step. Today is the only day you have. This present is the only time that you can change your life. Come now. Take that step, just one step in faith. Come now.
You give life, you are God, you bring life to the darkness, you give. Restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour.
Into your heart today and you see that you believe, if you've expressed that to God, then you're probably feeling safe and secure. But let me ask you, have you declared with your mouth, as God says, that Jesus is Lord of your life? If you declare with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that he was raised from the dead, you will be saved. Is Jesus your Savior, but not yet your Lord? Now's the time. Now's the only time you have. If Jesus is your Savior, but you've not declared him your Lord, come forward now. Open your heart to him. Let him transform your life. You have to declare with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord. You need to act today. Today is the only day you have. It may very well be your last day.
We'll shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
come here week after week, you probably believe, you may feel secure. Please make him the Lord of your life. The only thing that will save you from hell is Jesus, and his forgiveness is free. Right now, Satan's whispering, wait, you can do this alone in the privacy of your home. He's trying to stop you. He knows if he can get you to wait, he can keep you waiting. Don't listen to him. Romans 10:9 says, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Today is that day.
Grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Living one day at a time, enjoying one moment at a time, accepting hardship as a pathway to peace, taking as Jesus did this sinful world as it is, not as I would have it, trusting that you will make all things right if I surrender to your will, so that I may be reasonably happy in this life, and supremely happy with you forever in the next. Amen.
Thanks, Randy.
Thank you, Randy.
Thank you.
made Jesus the Lord of your life, if you haven't confessed that he's Lord, if you haven't given him control of the wheel, today's the day. You're missing out on the most abundant life that he has available for you. Heavenly Father, as we leave here today, I just ask that you will open our hearts to you throughout the week. Let us see you in our day. Let us see you in the events of our week. Help us to worship you completely this week. Help us to pray with you, pray to you continuously, Lord. Help us lift up our brothers and sisters. Please protect us and guide us and keep us close to you, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.